Hey everyone, this is Jayden Haidar, aka SpideyFan101. I'm here today with a long-awaited video. A video that I've wanted to make for so long. To the point where, you know, I have to get it out of the way. Like, I'm very passionate about this video, but I have to get out of the way before it becomes irrelevant. So, here we go. Today I wanted to talk about, you know, a topic that I've loved, about a group that I've loved ever since I was a kid, and I still love today, and that is the Fantastic Four. You know, I absolutely love the Fantastic Four. When I first got into them, I was a kid. It was in the mid to late 2000s, and I had come across, similar to how I came across Spider-Man, with Sam Raimi Spider-Man in a convenience store. It was the same thing with Fantastic Four. I saw the first film like as a DVD in a store, and I got it with my dad. And I watched the film, and I was just in love with it. Like, I watched it so many times over and over. I went first day to see the sequel, Rise of the Silver Surfer, and I absolutely love that film as well. You know, there's a part of me that's like, I don't think you could ever beat that era of Fantastic Four. Like, the 2000s was not only the most prominent era the Fantastic Four have ever had, you know, with two movies and a very underrated TV show that I love so much. I have the box set of it. But it's an era where I feel like the Fantastic Four were treated with such love and care by the filmmakers and the showrunner, or showrunners, I don't know how many showrunners World's Greatest Heroes had, but, you know, the people that made that show, such respect for them. And that was really the peak era, in my opinion. And the reason why, you know, I love the Fantastic Four is just because, it's not just because they're a family, but, and that is a big reason, but it's not because of that. It's because, for me, all of the characters in the Fantastic Four, like, really stand out with such great stories. Like, Reed, like, the futurist and the hardcore scientist who is always, you know, looking to discover the next big thing, while still trying to ground himself in the reality that's like right there with his girlfriend, or in some iterations his wife, and, you know, his longtime childhood friend Ben, you know, his wife's brother Johnny, and, you know, just taking in that moment, taking those moments with them as a family and as superheroes. With Susan being the glue that holds the team together, and really, you know, being the heart of the team. A lot of people say that the heart of the team would be either Johnny or Ben, but for me, I think it's Susan. I think, you know, she's a very underrated character, and she's one that I think people overlook a lot, but she's just such a great character. She has such great heart. You know, she cares about Reed and Johnny and Ben, and the stability of them as a team, as a family. She also cares about, you know, the well-being of others, and, you know, she's a very selfless person. That's something I've always loved about Susan, is how selfless she is, while at the same time, you know, caring so much about her family. And Ben, you know, Ben's story is super, is the ultimate, like, out-of-body type story. You know, when people see you as a freak and an outcast, and, you know, you really have to come to terms with the fact that, you know, you are who you are, and who you are ain't so bad. And for Ben, you know, that's the main theme of his character. Because a lot of times he's trying to be cured, and Reed's trying to find a cure for him. But, you know, over time, Ben just decides to live with it and really like embrace it in a lot of ways. And I've always loved that about his character, that arc. And Johnny's just a lot of fun. You know, he's a hothead with a tough exterior, but inside he is the most emotionally, you know, vulnerable out of all of them, because he cares about everybody the most, even though he doesn't acknowledge it. And, you know, that's the thing that I love most about Johnny, is that he comes off on the outside as this, like, hothead, as this hothead, as this guy who doesn't really care about anything, but on the inside, he's the one who cares the most. And, you know, it's like this whole team of the Fantastic Four is just such a great family, such a great dynamic, such a great group of characters. For the longest time, they were my favorite Marvel group in all of Marvel. That was until I saw X-Men Animated Series, of course, and then, you know, that they tied with the X-Men. But I just love the Fantastic Four so much. I don't even know if I can put it into words how much I love these guys. But, like, in my heart of hearts, I love the Fantastic Four so much. Ever since I was a kid, there's just something about them that stands out for me. And there's something about them that really shines amongst any other group of Marvel characters. You know, and they're second only to my Big Four when it comes to Marvel. Not in general, because there are some characters from other franchises and stories that, you know, kind of go on top of them. But in terms of Marvel, they're like right up there in my Big Four. I love the Fantastic Four so much, and I miss them. I miss them a whole lot, because, you know, of course we went through that whole era in the 2010s with Fant4Stick, and, you know, that film kind of leading to the death of Fantastic Four in comics for the longest time. And it broke my heart, because for a decade, we didn't get any more media. We didn't get any more comics. We didn't get any more anything with these characters. And it frustrated me to no end, because I would always, you know, rewatch the 2000s films and World's Greatest Heroes, and I'd be like, why can't we get this again? Why can't we get people that actually care about the Fantastic Four making these things and actually putting them in the forefront that they deserve? And because for the longest time, we just didn't get that, and I would be so angry. There are even some videos on my channel talking about that, and how, you know, I want the rights to Fantastic Four to go back to Marvel, because, you know, after the 2000s, they weren't treating Fantastic Four with respect at all. Matter of fact, they were actively ruining them in the public eye, and that's why I was so adamant. Because you could even hear in those videos, I was like, you could keep the X-Men, but just give the Fantastic Four back, because the Fantastic Four deserve better. And I'm so passionate about them, because I love those characters so much. And, you know, the media from of course, the original 2000s films, which are greatness. World's Greatest Heroes, which is perhaps the most definitive Fantastic Four story in media. And then Fant4Stick was just a hot pile of heaping trash. I think, you know, it's a mostly good run. Only carried by the 2000s, though. So, for me, this is why I was just so jaded, because, you know, the comics are great. You know, some of my favorite runs being the Jonathan Hickman run that was one of the first ones starting to lead into this whole Secret Wars event. And then my second favorite one, or just my favorite one right now, being the more recent run that started in 2022 and is still going. That one is absolutely wonderful. You know, so the comics are great. The 2000s era of Fantastic Four media was great, but that was it for a long time, you know? Which is why this new era of Fantastic Four really excites me. Now, as we all know, there is a new movie for the Fantastic Four coming out next year, in fact. A film by the name of THE Fantastic. That's how you know they're making a claim that this is their definitive version. It's called THE Fantastic Four First Steps. And, you know, this version of Fantastic Four, you know, has went through so much speculation, so much, you know, everything like director changes and everything. They finally landed on Matt Shakman, who was one of the directors on WandaVision. And, you know, WandaVision, even though it has problems, I think it is still relatively a good show. Yeah, if I said, you know, when I said that I hated the show, that was me back when I was jaded about Marvel Studios. But regardless, I think it's still a good show. And, you know, him doing the Fantastic Four sounds great to me. And then they revealed the cast, which, you know, Pedro Pascal, Vanessa Kirby, Joseph Quinn, Eben Moss Bachrach. I was initially conflicted on Pedro because personally I wanted them to get Patrick Wilson as Reed Richards. I was one of those people. It's like, yeah, Patrick Wilson, Ray Richards. But, you know, Pedro Pascal, what really sold me on Pedro Pascal as Reed Richards was the initial illustrated photo that was released earlier this year. Then I could see the vision. Like everybody else, I was good with, but Pedro, I need to see the vision. And then, you know, with that picture, I saw the vision. And then, you know, that other picture that they showed on, it was like 4 Day or something, I don't know, showing this new version of Johnny we're gonna get, making the four in the sky, like he would always do, like the 2000s version of him would always do at the end of the movies. Yeah, I love to see it. I love to see it. I hope he actually does that at the end of this movie. But what really got me excited for this iteration was not only those images, but it was also the recent Comic-Con footage that was shown this past weekend. Now, obviously, I saw the footage. I'm not going to tell you how, though. And, you know, the footage was absolutely, to me at least, was absolutely breathtaking. Seeing, like, this new version of Reed almost being, like, a teacher in a sense. I don't know if, you know, the kids he was teaching was for the Future Foundation, but, you know, it was giving off those vibes. And he was teaching the kids about parallel dimensions and how there's a correlation that, you know, alternate universes are real. And he sees the kids are bored and he's like, who wants to see an explosion? And then they go nuts, and, you know, he brings a rocket into the classroom and just has it, you know, go on. And, you know, and then the whole trailer, they're showing like it's basically a sizzle reel. They confirm that these things are not actually going to be in the movie. They're just stuff that they filmed for the audience to get a feel of what the tone is going to be. And, you know, it's great. Like, we see certain images of like the spaceship that they're going to be using to travel like a lot through space. I assume that they're going to be some sequences in space in this movie, and that's another thing that I'm excited for with this film, is the fact that we are going to see the more Star Trek side of the Fantastic Four. Because there are multiple levels to Fantastic Four. There's the more grounded stories with like Mole Man and Dr. Doom, kinda, and stuff. And then there's the stuff where they go out into space and they're, you know, traveling planets and universes and different realms and everything. You know, the Star Trek side of Fantastic Four. The cosmic side of Fantastic Four. And, you know, all these years we've been seeing the more grounded side of Fantastic Four, and I've loved the grounded side of Fantastic Four, very much so. But I like the fact that we're starting to see the more cosmic side of Fantastic Four now. Like, the closest we got to the cosmic side was Rise of the Silver Surfer, when we had Norn Rad and Cloud Galactus in the movie. But, you know, it was still very much so tapping the surface. They never really went into space. It's like the characters themselves never went to space. They never really did any like planetary conquests or anything like that. Like, it was just like stuff from space and Norn Rad and Galactus, Cloud Galactus coming to Earth to consume it. And, you know, that was what that was. But, you know, this is the first time, because this time we're not only getting a Silver Surfer who is not Norn Rad, but is Norn Rad's wife. And this time we're getting the real Galactus, who by the way is absolute nightmare fuel in this movie. The last shot of this trailer, him peeking out like a stalker in a skyscraper window, was horrifying. Literally, if they keep that tone with Galactus, whew! Oh man, oh boy, you might as well add horror to the list of genres that the movie qualifies for. But yeah, and it's also a little bit interesting why he's... because Galactus is supposed to be bigger than planets, but he was small enough to peek through a skyscraper window. It's interesting to see. I've been thinking about it for a little bit now, like, if his size was changed at all, or if he can just actively change sizes on a whim. But regardless, absolute nightmare fuel this version of Galactus is. But you know, it's great to see all these cosmic elements. We didn't see Norn Rad's wife in the trailer. It was just more of a, which I like, because this trailer, this sizzle reel, was focusing more on, you know, who the individual members. You know, how Reed and Susan always have like family dinner, and how, you know, Ben is trying to get on a game show, or isn't a game show, like one of those things where a girl has to choose someone she's gonna go on a date with that's, you know, submerged in shadow, so you can only see their silhouette. And, you know, she says, I'm choosing guy number three. And, you know, it's just guy number three, and we find out guy number three is the Thing, or Ben, and in his rock form, which, I mean, that CGI, I don't know if it's finished or not, but it looks pretty finished to me. He looked great. But, you know, we never saw him, like, in his full rock form that's not, like, in shadow or from the back. So I'm assuming they're still working on that. I mean, they haven't even filmed the movie yet. By the time I'm recording this, they start filming it tomorrow. So that's exciting. But, you know, they show Susan like joking around at Johnny's expense, talking about how he's super single, and Johnny's like, hey, what? Don't listen to her. And then they go up into space. And what's interesting about the new theme, which is being composed by Michael Giacchino, my guy, one of the greatest composers of our time, I would say, is the modern day John Williams. I know a lot of people would say that, you know, the modern day John Williams would be Alan Silvestri, and there's a good argument for that. But for me, Michael Giacchino is this generation's John Williams. And it's great. Like, John Ottman composed the soundtracks for the first two movies. Marco Beltrami did the one for Fantastic, which, to be honest, was the best part of that movie. And now we get Michael G, the legend Michael G, composing the new soundtrack for this new Fantastic Four movie. And it's interesting that the theme, from what I could hear of it from the sizzle reel, sounds like super retro and, you know, techno, but not in a way where most MCU soundtracks have been since Ant-Man, to where it's like just a collection of like that garbage. No, I'm talking about like super unique and just super, super old school, which is very fitting because this movie takes place in a sick alternate universe 60s, where it's retro futuristic and everything looks like, you know, there's hover cars, there's everything, and that's awesome. Like, including the Fantastic Car, which looks great as well. But what surprised me about the theme is that, you know, Fantastic Four themes have always had, even when you look at World's Greatest Heroes, it's always had that like techno feel that carries through even with this theme. But this time, you literally have a choir going Fantastic Four. Like, it's literally like their theme is just their name being shouted by a choir with the techno mute. And I don't know how to feel about that, because the soundtrack I really like, because it's kind of like, if I were to describe it, it's like a mix between the soundtrack of Lightyear and the soundtrack of, like, yeah, it's like the soundtrack of Lightyear if it was more techno. Like, yeah, that's the best way I could describe it. But it sounds great, but the whole, like, you know, Fantastic Four, like that one, I'm like, I don't know. I'd have to, that's something I feel like I have to get used to over time. But regardless, yeah, I mean, the film is looking great so far. It's looking like the new iteration of Fantastic Four that I've always wanted to see. Finally, the Fantastic Four being given spotlight again. And, you know, the cast looks great. They looked a little suspicious there when it came to the most recent Comic-Con. I don't know if they're all jet-lagged or tired or something, but, you know, they just looked a little awkward, I'm not gonna lie. But in the footage, they look great. They look great together. So, yeah. I'm very excited. And then RDJ as Victor. I know, you know, this has been the talk of the town ever since Comic-Con a couple days ago. You know, RDJ as Victor. But that, I mean, there's a vision there, clearly. Because we know now that the Fantastic Four are going to be in Avengers Doomsday and Avengers Secret Wars. And of course, because of Dr. Doom, you know, that's their villain. So obviously they have to be there to take care of him. But it brings up a lot of questions. Like, for one thing, I'm very excited to see this, to see RDJ's Doom go up against this Fantastic Four. That would be very exciting. I don't think it's going to happen in this movie because there's already a lot going on with Nightmare Fuel Galactus and this new Silver Surfer that we're about to get, Norm Red's wife. But I'm very much so looking forward to seeing them, you know, meet and really be at odds with each other. And you know what this version of Victor has been through, what's his backstory, you know, what's his whole situation, is he even gonna be the Victor from their universe, or is it just an Avengers thing to do on a thematic level? Who knows? I'll talk about that possibility more in my MCU trilogy series that I'm working on right now. But overall, you know, I absolutely love the Fantastic Four. The 2000s films, World's Greatest Heroes, the comics. Even though I hate Fanforstic, there are still times where I'm like, you know, but I remember it fondly. I love the comics as well, and I am very excited for this new film. And, you know, all I want is to see the Fantastic Four done justice, because out of all the heroes in Marvel, they have been the ones that have been underlooked the most. And so I want them to get their due. It's been a long time since they've been on the screen, but I hope and pray as a fan that they get their due, because they deserve it. So yeah, I love this team. I love these characters ever since I was a kid, and I can't wait to see the future potential for these characters in media, in comics, and just in general. Yeah, and don't even get me started on what happened to Reed in Doctor Strange 2. And spoiler alert, if you haven't seen Deadpool and Wolverine, Johnny in Deadpool and Wolverine. Don't even get me started. Don't even get me started. Just give them their due. Please. Please. But yeah. I wanted to make that video for a long time because I haven't talked about the Fantastic Four on this channel since like those early day videos back in like 2017. It's been a long time. And, you know, I'm in an age now where, a day and age, not an actual age, where I want to make it known how much I love these characters and how much I'm rooting for them to succeed. And, you know, the Fantastic Four have always been on that list. So, I've finally gotten a chance to make this video, and I feel good about it. So, yeah. I am Jane Hydar, aka SpideyFan101, saying peace.